He is awesome. He's powerful. And he is worthy. Amen. He's worthy of much more than I believe that we give him. And I say we. I'm not trying to preach a message that causes any kind of condemnation. If it brings some conviction, praise the Lord. Because I believe that we need conviction in our lives. Amen.
Amen.
I believe we need to hear a voice when we step out of alignment of what God's Word says. And I'm thankful for conviction in my life. You know, it is an honor and a privilege to be up here. I'm excited. And most of you that heard me speak, you know that I get very fired up very quickly. And I just begin to look the Word of God. Amen. It comes out a lot. I love to read Scripture, and God has truly changed me from the inside, and I have a strong desire, and very passionate, very serious about what would come out of my mouth if I'm given the opportunity to come up here. Not to mention, it is a little, I do experience a little nervousness, amen, that God would take a person like me, going and being who I was and where I was, and see me fit to stand before his sons and daughters and deliver his message. I mean, that's pretty amazing, amen?
Amen?
Because I know on my best day, I'm all about a bag of potato chips and the television, amen? That's my understanding. But God in his infinite wisdom has shown me his love and his mercy, and it has caused me to look into his word. And when I looked into his word, it showed me a different road. A road that the world does not see. Amen. A road that I believe is on the inside of each one of us. And we're all searching for it each and every day. But the truth is that when we get up and we walk in the natural, we walk in our old nature, in our old ways, we never seem to get, no matter how much we work, no matter how much we strive, we never seem to get to where we want to be. But there is a way that God has given us very clearly in his word, that when we begin to kneel down and pray, when we begin to open his word and let it wash our mind, then the influence and the power of temptation loses its grip on us and something happens on the inside of our mind. Amen. The Bible says it very clearly in Romans. It says, do not conform to the world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Amen. And that's why no matter what's going on in my life, I get excited when I come into the house of God. Not only do I get to rub shoulders with other believers, but I'm in a place where I can express my love for what God has done in my life. And it is an honor and a privilege to be able to do that, and I want to do that with the reverence God deserves and with the excellence he deserves. Amen. And sometimes that can be very fearful, very scary. And the Bible tells us over 365 times to fear not. Amen. There is nothing to fear but fear itself, right? What do we fear? See, just going on that statement right there, we have to look at what we fear and why we fear what we fear. Because when you begin to answer your question, what am I fearing and why I'm fearing, it asks you some other questions. What are you trying to do? Where are you trying to get to? And why are you experiencing this fear? I love what Elder George had shared with us, that the definition of fear is false evidence appearing real. Things that come at us and we think they have the power to overtake us or overcome us. But when we're walking in the truth of who God created us to be, that fear loses its presence. It not only loses its presence, but it loses its power. Because Scripture tells us that the truth will set us free. Amen? And that's why I believe I believe that we are to stir one another up, that we are to encourage each other. And I have a great desire to do that, and I'm asking God to teach me how to do that better. Because I want to stir the body of Christ up in love. Amen? I don't want to do it out of pressure or out of fear, but out of love. Because there is a place that we can get to that I believe that every one of us wants to go. But you can't get there by your natural mind. You can't get there by your own efforts. It is through faith. Amen? It is through faith. What God did was extend His grace. Amen? Let me stop real quick. I want to pray before I continue to speak because I'm already going too fast. Lord God, I just thank You for tonight, God. I thank You for what You're about to do. I thank You for the opportunity for outreach that's coming up tomorrow and Saturday, Father. I ask, Lord, that You would remind us as this day unfolds and tomorrow comes, Father, that we would be about Your business. Lord God, I just pray right now, Father, that You would take anything that would hinder Your word from coming through clearly. And Father, that You would remove it. I repent of it. And I ask You to create a clean heart and a right spirit in me. God, I thank You for the opportunity to stand before my brothers and sisters. But we've all come and we're here in one accord expecting You to speak directly to us. And so, Lord, I just give You my tongue. I give You my heart. I give You my life. And I thank You for this opportunity. I ask You to just bless each one of us here. Strengthen us. Convict us. Give us what we need so that we will walk more like You and less like us. In Jesus' name, everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Everybody said,
amen.
Everybody said,
amen.
You know you can't get a ticket for saying amen.
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 You can't get pulled over for saying praise God.
Praise God.
You can't even get a ticket for carrying your Bible.
Amen.
But you watch. Those days could be upon us. You and I take it for granted the Word of God that we carry. And we take it for granted so much that we leave out its power in our lives. I was thinking a lot about this. And that's why we need to pray, because God just totally redirected me right now back to what I was thinking about. We need faith, right? How does faith come? Faith comes by hearing the news, right? Hearing CNN? Faith comes by listening to Oprah. Faith comes by watching Jerry Springer. Faith comes by being on Facebook. Faith comes by sitting in the movie house on Friday night. Where does faith come from? By hearing the Word of God. Amen? We need faith now more than ever. We need faith in abundance. We need faith that is visible. We need faith that is tangible. When we interact with one another, we need to interact in faith so that the love of God has the opportunity to transact in the middle of our communication. Amen? I want to have a transaction with communities and humanity and people that I work with. But I don't want to come off as just another good employee. I don't want to come off as an offensive employee. I don't want to come off as an angry, frustrated, confused, where is that guy coming from? I want to come off as a child of God that bears something inside of me that makes that person say, I want what that person has. Amen? It takes faith to get us to that place. Amen? God did not create junk. Amen? God is not trying to recreate something He already created. Amen? God has already fixed everything He's created. And it's up to you and I to go to the OEM repair manual and begin to walk like God called us to walk. To begin to talk like God called us to talk. Amen? To begin to express love like God called us to express. Amen? To get excited about the things that God called us to get excited about. You know me. I love to attack football. Amen? Where people paint their faces, put on jerseys, and spend all kinds of money every year chasing a team that didn't deliver them from anything. As a matter of fact, it actually gave you some anxiety, some frustration, and a little bit of pride. Amen? If they ever went to the Super Bowl. Amen? Yeah, my team's in the Super Bowl. That's why I tell people, you know, my team wins the Super Bowl every year. And they get that weird look. I'm like, yep, that's it right there. That look on your face. What do you mean? The team that wins, that's my team. Amen? I'm not consumed by it. Do I enjoy watching? You bet. I love watching a couple of plays. But it doesn't consume my life. Amen? And this is not a condemnation about you and where you're watching football. It is a message of God saying that we have let the standards and the ways of the world become who we are. We receive our identity by the amount of money in our bank account. We receive our identity by the amount of likes on our Facebook. Amen. We receive our identity by the number of people who sit next to us in church. We get our identity from the world's ways and not from this scripture. Amen. And the pastor can get up here and preach, and he has done a great job of opening our eyes and unlocking the ability of God to interact in our lives. But nothing will change until you implement your faith, your side of that. Amen. The Bible says that we are saved by grace through faith. Amen. Grace was God's part when He saw how we were and we needed to be reconciled to Him and we didn't follow any of His ways. He said, okay, I love you enough. I'm going to go ahead and fix that part too. Here, I fixed it. You're reconciled to me. Now by faith, you can walk with me. You can grow with me. You can mature in the things that I have already written, and they will produce for you an armor that you can put on every day that will shake the foundations of the world that we live in. Amen? Hallelujah. I was going fast right there. I wanted to slow down. I do. I get excited. God is good. Amen?
All the time.
Oh, we got a verse. We're in church. We better read scripture. Amen? Hallelujah. Psalms 19. The Bible says that the heavens declare the glory of God. And the firmament shows His handiwork. The Bible says that you and I are His handiwork. Amen? And I was talking to Pastor about firmament a little bit ago. I'm kind of stuck on this word in the gospel right now because it's actually the extension of God. It's heaven, amen, in our midst. It's not the land, it is heaven. It is the extension of heaven. It is the windows of heaven. The heavens declare the glory of God. Watch this. You and I came here because we need something, right? And if we were to say what it was, I need heaven right now. I want the glory of God in my life. Amen? I want the authority of God in my life. So why don't we take that scripture and let's just call out and say, heaven?
Heaven.
No, 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 no. You're talking like you don't want that. Say, heaven?
Heaven.
I call
on the glory of God.
Come now.
Glory.
Of God.
I want you.
In my life.
Teach me.
How.
To receive.
The glory.
Of God.
In Jesus'
name.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Something happens when we start reciting God's word right back to Him. Amen. Causes us to clap and shout. Causes us to let go of the circumstances that we were just all, I don't know how I'm going to do this and get to there and pay that bill and get to that appointment. And that stuff, that's what it looks like, right? It's like God is wrapped up. We walk into church, it's like, how you doing, brother? I hope you don't tell me because I really don't want to know. Amen. We do that, right? We put on our church communication. I am blessed, brother. Hallelujah. Right? And this stuff is just... Don't even ask me how I'm blessed. That's what we want. Don't even ask me how I'm doing. Do you really want to know? Check this out. My kids can't follow the rules. My bills are stacked up. Right? Those are some of the things that try and rise up out of us, right? Let's be honest here. Anybody else ever do that? Watch this. When we have our stance and our identity in the world, that's all that can flow out of us. Because our mind is completely focused not on this, but how am I going to get my children to where they need to be? How am I going to get that bank account fuller? How am I going to get my hair to do exactly what I made it do tonight? Amen. Right? Praise the Lord. You want to go on a dirt road? Watch. Get out, lock the hubs. So I got out of the shower and I'm excited, right? I get to spend time with God. And I did this crazy thing with my hair in the gel because it was wet. And I was just crazy. And I was like, what's going to happen if you leave it there? And so I looked and I go, man, that looks crazy. That's all right, I'll leave it. So I got down and I started spending time with God. But this is actually called something. And I didn't know that until I got here. My daughter said, what is that? Did you faux-hawk your hair? And I'm like, praise the Lord, at least I know what it is now, amen? It's not a five-hawk or a mohawk, it's a faux-hawk. C5 faux-hawk. God is good, amen? So, let's wash the car back up and get back on the road of salvation. We have to maintain our spiritual life, amen? I don't know about you, but I come into church and I get filled and I hear things coming out of the pastor's mouth and it does. If you listen to him, he doesn't usually put a lot of scripture on the board, but what amazes me is that scripture just flows out of his mouth. And it gets me excited, and I'm like, yeah, God's talking to me. Pastor, you're following me around. There's something here for me, right? And we get all excited, and we make these little commitments to God on the inside, and then we go back out in the world, and we're kind of bound up again. It may last an hour, it may last, but what I want you to get tonight is that faith unlocks the door to the grace of God. Amen. Faith is our participation in the kingdom of heaven. Just like we just called down the glory of God, go to the next scripture in Ephesians 2, verse 4. Amen? Hallelujah. Somebody say praise God.
Praise God.
Watch this. I love what, but God, right? I love when God puts a but. But God, who is rich in his mercy, because of his great love with which he loves us, even when we were dead, right? In trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised us up together, amen, and made us sit together in heavenly places. So that heaven that we're talking about when we say the heavens declare the glory of God, that tells me that you and I are part of that declaration. And it doesn't happen when we just enter this building on Thursday or we enter a building on Sunday. It happens when we say, you are my Lord and you are my shepherd, and I will go the way that you have called me to go. I will go into your word and build my faith. As a matter of fact, I want you to come into my heart, Father, and I want you to tear out everything that does not belong to me. Everything that does not belong to you. Everything that got me distracted and disrupted and dysfunctional. I want you to go into my heart, God, and I'm going to go into your word. And I want you to begin to pull those things out from the deepest roots that they came from. And I want to walk in the victory that you gave me. It takes faith to make that statement. Amen? It takes courage to make that statement. But it takes faith to make that statement become revelation. Amen? You're going to have to not only choose to say something, but to do something about your recovery if you want to recover. Amen? If you want to be saved and know that you are saved, then the Bible says that all who call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Don't stop calling on the name of the Lord. Amen? Don't stop pursuing the things of God, because the Bible tells us faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. When we get in His presence and we have Scripture going in and we are listening and we're attentive in church and we're going not out of selfish ambition or out of a way to just receive something else other than what God has for us, then things begin to move into a place, amen, that we can not only experience the goodness of God, but we can see the hand of God come into our lives and actually start to pull out the things that we have been so bound up with. Amen? Man, this message is getting good. Do you want to know how I know? Because I'm starting to speak. That means I'm getting some more saliva so I can talk even faster because God's using me right now, right? No, it doesn't. The goodness of God is awesome, amen? And I know each one of us here want the goodness of God, amen? Right now I'm in this place where I want the goodness of God, not just for my own life and for my marriage, which is awesome, but I want it for my children. I said this and I'm going to keep saying this. I don't want my children to have to make 100 mistakes to figure out there's another way to live. I don't want my children to have to be bound up and thrown into all these sorceries and wrong roads and led by the world so that they can figure out there is a different way to go. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen? Sometimes that don't look too pretty for a teenager. Amen? Because the world's not serving the Lord. So we have to make moral decisions in our home over what comes through the TV. We have to take a spiritual stance over our children. One of the things I share all the time is I pray almost every night with Deborah and I ask God to expose the things in our home that need to be exposed. Yeah, all right, yeah. Do you know what God does? He exposes them. Amen? Because the Bible tells us that we fight against principalities of an unseen world. That our war is not with each other. Our war is not with humanity. Our war is with principalities of an unseen world. Amen? And our selfishness and our flesh and our pride and our brokenness can leave us in a place where we never experience the goodness and the authority of God. I've seen it way too long and way too far in America. And I believe that it's time for the church to get shaken up. Because if you're not about your love for God and your faith in God and for the love that He's given you through the blood of Jesus, to not only say, you know what you've already done, it's done. I forgive you. As far as the east is from the west. So don't even stay there anymore. As a matter of fact, all I'm asking you to do is to come into communication with me. Let my word seep into your mind. And let it begin to wash your thoughts and clean you up. And let it begin to give you some place and some direction and some foundation. Because I'm the one who spoke you into existence in your mother's womb.
Amen.
I'm the one that planned the days of your life. I'm the one that numbered the hairs upon your head. The Bible says that you are the apple of God's eye. The Bible says that you are His prized possession and that He who began a good work in you will complete it until the day that Jesus comes back. Amen? Until then, we have an opportunity to be a son to our Father. We have a privilege and a clear description of what He expects of us. The Bible tells us that the sheep hear the shepherd's voice. I want to tell you, there, just like you just said, there are many shepherds that will stand up here and tell you what you want to hear. And you will go away bound up by your own understanding. You need to unlock the authority of God for your own heart, your mind, your soul, right? Jesus didn't come to save your Impala. He didn't come to save... Yeah, he didn't save you so you could have a two-story house with a white picket fence around it. Right. He didn't. He saved you so that you could be redeemed, reconciled to him, the one that created you. So that you could commune with him. Sometimes this book seems a little far-fetched for us. It's a little hard to read. That's because it's not a story that isn't real. This is truth. And the truth isn't always sweet. Amen. Sometimes the truth is confrontational. But since I began this walk and this journey 14 years ago, I have realized one thing. God never took something away from me that I didn't need to give up in the first place. Amen. And it was only because, not only was he working, because the Bible says that he never leaves us or forsakes us. The Bible says that he is able to do exceedingly and above and beyond what we could ever think or imagine. You know what's lacking? Our sight of it. We put on our worldly attitude, our worldly boots, and we walk in Facebook, and then we wonder why we're so confused and bound up. Amen? Listen. Hallelujah. Jesus. Where did I say I was going to go? To Ephesians? Or no, Hebrews, huh? Hallelujah.
You're going to go to Romans.
Romans 3. Thank you, brother. I love Fred. He tells me what I'm supposed to do. Romans 3. Hallelujah. God is good?
Amen.
Are you getting anything out of this?
Yes.
Good, because I'm sweating up here. Amen. That's all right. I sweat all the time working in the world. I might as well sweat for Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I love being used by God. Amen. I love being a blessing to somebody else. There's nothing that excites me more. Amen. But I have to learn how to channel it and balance that, because I've learned that the world we live in is really needy. Amen. And it doesn't always want the things of God. What it wants is the things of the world, and it wants you to hand them to it. Amen. Point being, those people that are out there on G Street, the homeless, 80% of the people that you go up and talk to and ask if you can help them out, they don't want your help. Amen? They want a handout.
That's right.
They choose to be in that place because they don't want to live under the standards of the world. Amen? Which I can definitely relate to. Amen? But it doesn't mean that we give up on our family and on society. It means that we get to a place where we realize we were created for much more. Amen? And we have to draw spiritual boundaries. Amen? That's why I've developed that spiritual boundary in my life when I deal with people like that, because I love them. As a matter of fact, I have a desire to help them out. But I'm not supposed to just hand them money and hope they'll make the right decision. Amen? I'm supposed to tell them, hey, let's go to McDonald's. Where do you want to go? Let's go to McDonald's. Go wherever you want. I'll buy you whatever you want. Oh, no, that's okay. You don't know how many times I've heard that. And it amazes me, because what they said is I was hungry. So what that tells me is, if you have your spiritual eyes and ears on, is they're hungry for something that the world can't give them. Amen? Because they can stand on the road and make more than I can in a day, going to a job and giving effort to receive my employment. Amen? They make more in one day than I can going to a job and giving effort to receive something. Amen? That tells me that our foundation, our society is broken. And the church is called to fix that. Amen? You and I are called to be a part of the solution. To be the hands and feet of Jesus. Amen? Let's read this next scripture in Romans. Hallelujah. Verse 21. Glory to God. Somebody say glory to God.
Glory to God.
Here's God saying, but, again, but now, watch this, the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed. How many of you right now would raise your hand if I told you you could see the righteousness of God? Do you want to see it? Amen? We want the righteousness of God. We want to be in right relationship. We want to be something, someone that God can use so that we can experience what His plan is. Amen? To be in right relationship with God. Listen, it says, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus, not in your own simple plan, not in your own interpretation of the Bible wrapped up in your own agenda, but in the plan of Jesus Christ. Amen? It has to be solidified by the foundation that is the only foundation that a child of God can operate in. There is only one foundation, and nobody else can build another foundation. Amen? That is why we see in Genesis 11 that the people came together and they had this great and mighty plan. And it may not sound very bad to you. They wanted to build something to represent their ability to build and their ability to be strong and powerful. And God looked down on them and He said, look, all these people are coming together and they're going to build something, but they're building it for the wrong reasons. The Bible says that if God is not the builder, that the labor is in vain. So if you come in here and you're trying to get to an understanding of who God is, and you're doing it out of selfish ambition or wrong motive, then you're going to stay stuck. It must be out of your love for what God did for you. You can all stand up and testify to where God reached into your heart and He touched it. And you said, you know what? I want a relationship with this God. And you made that confession. You said with your own mouth, Father, I ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and my shepherd. Amen? Amen. That means lift me up when I fall down. And I will walk in a way that you told me to walk. Amen? Amen. If something is Lord over you, then you walk where that thing tells you to walk. You say what that thing tells you to say. Because you said you wanted it to Lord over you. Amen? Amen. Stop letting Facebook Lord over your time. Ouch. If that hurt, I am not sorry. Amen?
Amen.
We find our identity in the most simplest of uneventful things. We do. Okay, so I'm going to try this. I've been trying to find this illustration. I've been struggling with it, but I'm going to do this. How many of you have decided to go to the movies? Right? We've all been to the movies. Yeah. You decide to go to the movies, and you pull into the movies, and you realize you had something else to do, and you say, you know what? This is not going to work out. I've got to go do something else. How many of you have done that? How many of you have walked into a movie theater, and for no apparent reason, during the middle of the movie, a matter of fact, it was quite good, but you said, you know what? I remembered I had something to do. I'm going to take off. Didn't happen. How about this? How many of us have children, right? You decide to go to your son's or your daughter's game, baseball, whatever it is. And you pull into the game and you think, you know what? I just remembered I had something else I had to go do. I'm going to go do that. Or you got there and you were watching your son or your daughter and they were just grinned from ear to ear because you were in the stands. And all of a sudden you got this thought and you just decided, you know what, I'm going to take off. I'll just take off. You didn't do that, right? So can you answer this? Why do we come into the place called the church where God says that He's going to reconcile us to Him, and that not only is He going to reconcile us and wash away our sin, but He's going to empower us to overcome the things of the world, and He's going to give us authority to cast down devils, to heal the sick, to walk in places that the world cannot walk, and to watch His presence manifest on the inside of us to do marvelous miracles. Amen? Why is it that we come into a place and we get as far as, amen, I'm a participator, but I don't know about all the rest of that stuff? Because our commitment level is not where it needs to be. Because our faith hasn't been developed. Because our maturity as Christians is still mixed with the maturity of the world. The Bible says, how can clean water and salt water fall out of the same spout? Stream spout? Well, I was looking for that other word. I still can't find it. Spigot, yeah. It can't be the same, amen? When you want a peach, you don't go to the grapevines to get it. Amen? If I had an apple in my hand and I squeezed it, what would it make? If I had an orange in this hand and I squeezed it, what would it make? What if I squeezed the orange and it made apple juice? Okay, so if you're a Christian and you get squeezed by the world, what does it make? If you're a Christian and you get squeezed by the world, what does it make? Amen. What does the world see?
Jesus.
He was persecuted for our sins. He was struck down and destroyed for our rebellion. It was our sins and iniquities that He took to the cross. And what He tells us is to pick up our cross and follow Him. This right here is your cross. And it will unveil the grace of God to you. It will get you in right standing with God. And it will show you things that you don't even think you have the power to accomplish. But I guarantee you this, if you continue to walk by faith, you will achieve great and mighty miracles. You will see authority, and you will see the very things that we fight against become weak and less powerful, and watch the authority, the love, the fruit, the mercy of God rise up in your life. Amen? That's what I want, not only for my family, but for my community. Not only for my community, but for my church. I want to see every part of the body operating. Amen? Every part of the body. The Bible says that we are the body of the Christ. Amen? We are the body of Christ. We are the hands and feet of Jesus. So if I get up and my hand's hurting or it decides it doesn't want to go to work today, guess what? I'm going to have difficulty working. Amen? And if you get up and you do not sow into your relationship with God, and you do not actively pursue Him, then you are in danger of not only hurting yourself and making decisions that will paralyze you in the move of God and cause you maybe even to backslide. Right? Or you can get up and say, good morning, Father. I'm tired, I don't want to be here, but I'm here because I love You. And I'm going to read Your word right now, and I need You to help me. I need You to help me to grow and become more like You and less like me. I need You to help me to be a parent. I need You to help me to be a father. I need You to help me to be a husband. I need You to help me to be a better member, a better son to You, because You are my Heavenly Father. And you spend some time in His word and you let it come into your life, and then you get up and you walk it out.
Amen.
And when you say it like that, it's really pretty simple. But the truth is there are a lot of people that are slacking and find that very difficult to get into that position and that posture. That is the difference between a Christian that has experienced the overcoming mercy of God and a Christian that is just struggling and going through the motions. Amen? They learn how to talk, they learn how to show up, they learn how to tithe, they learn how to do all these things, but they never experienced the supernatural. And I believe that God has given us not only this work to reconcile Him, but to fill us up to overflowing. Amen? To give us the abundant life. To make us not only say that we are a new creation, but to become a new creation. And that the old things that I struggled with and used to bind me up, no longer bind me up, because I am a child of God. And He gives me a platform. He gives me a road to walk down. And He says not to do this and yes to do this. And that's what I do. Not because I'm trying to work my salvation and get it to Him, but because I love Him and He changed my life. Amen. Salvation comes from that. Amen.
The Bible says to work out your salvation. What kind of a workout plan do you got? Amen? You need a mentor in your life speaking into you, pulling your covers, and asking you how much Bible you're reading and what that word said to you. You need to develop a prayer life and get down on your knees and say, you know what, Father, I don't know what to say, but there's some things coming to mind. I have a sister that just went to the hospital this morning. She's 45 years old. They said she had a heart attack. I'm asking you to open her eyes, amen? Not only help her physically, but I'm asking you to help her spiritually, Father. You know what? There's a situation in my child's school, and I'm just asking you to intervene. There is a world that is falling you apart, and I don't know how to engage in it, but I'm actually engaging in it right now. And I want you to move and show me what my position is. I want to pray for those who are bound up and those who are struggling with addiction. I want to pray for those who are sitting in the churches and feel like they're not a part of the body. Help me to give me the right words to encourage them to stand up on the road of salvation and begin to make a difference in what we are doing. The righteousness of God. It's not just something we read about. It's something that we can walk in. I can do something, but I don't have enough time. My wife walks in the righteousness of God. Amen? She does things that just amaze me all the time. She goes faster than I want to go, and she talks more than I want to talk. And that's okay to say that, right? But the truth is I've watched God come alongside her and help her build a ministry to reconcile God's daughters out of the hand of not only perversion, but confusion, chaos, addiction, and all those other abuses that the enemy wants to steal, kill, and destroy each one of our family members. And she said, you know what? I will make a difference. That didn't come from her own understanding. She got down on the cross. She was running 100 miles an hour in the wrong direction one day. And she said, you know what? I'm going the other way. I'm going back to my roots. I'm going back to that child that was sitting underneath the pew while they were bouncing up and down and miracles were happening. I'm going back to my Father's house. Amen? God is waiting for us to stand up and express our love for Him through our faith in Him. Amen? Put on the armor of Christ. It's not too far. It's not too hard to wear. It fits you just perfectly. Nobody's asking you to stand up and be like Pastor Robert or Pastor Pablo. Nobody's asking you to stand up and be like Will. Nobody's asking you to do something that you're not capable of doing. Amen? Praise God for that. Amen? There are days I can be transparent here. I've got like 5 minutes left. But there are days I'm like, Lord, I can't speak. I don't know how to say what Pastor Robert says. Amen? And God says, son, what are you doing? Well, he just said that scripture, and I know it's good, and I know it's a part, but I don't know how to explain it like he did. He did a good job. And he said, will you just get up there and let me use you? Yes, I will. But it's going to look like me. I'm going to spit on people, I'm going to sweat, I'm going to jump, and I'm going to scream because I love you. Get all the way through this. Even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all. Amen? To all and on all. Let's go there. To all and on all. It's not just for me, Mikey. It's to all.
Amen.
And it's not just in me. It's in all. Amen. It's in all. What? In all who believe.
Amen.
Go to Hebrews 11 so I can close. Hallelujah. The Bible just said, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory. Amen. If you didn't catch that last part, he said we all started from the same spot. Amen. But he gave us some instruction. He said, I love you. Come back into my... Remember the prodigal son? Check it out. I want my money now. I want this now. I see the Impala and the rims in there. I want them right now. I'll be back. Let me bump this song and go down the road. Don't tell me what I'm supposed to listen to and how reserved I'm supposed to be because I'm still a Christian. Look at my rims, man. And the prodigal son got what he was asking for.
just like you and I. God has given us something that I really wish he didn't have, but it's called what?
Will.
That's exactly, not that will, another one. He's given us free will, amen? You can do what you want, amen? I thank God for that will, too.
Amen.
I told him the other night, I said, man, you came in, got on fire for God, you encouraged me, amen? God has given us all free will, so he's not going to knock on your door and say, you know what, David? Tomorrow I'm going to expect you to pray for 2.5 hours, and I want you to be on 67 and 3rd Street, and I want you to witness to the purple person with the purple hair for 15 minutes and tell him how good I am. Amen. Watch this. God gets so detailed that when we pursue him, all of a sudden we end up in his presence, and for some reason we end up on that corner, and we see the guy with purple hair, and we ask him if he knows Jesus. Why? Because I may be in this world, but I'm not of this world.
Yeah.
Amen?
Right.
I may have a job, but I am employed by my Father. Amen?
Oh man, I'm getting excited.
Jesus. Hebrews 11:1. What does it say? Oh man. First three words. First three words. First three words. When is it? What is it? What is it? When is it?
Yeah.
Where does it happen?
Now.
We're lost. First three words. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. Now, if I asked you if you could have anything in the world, what would it be? You would probably say an Impala with big rims, right? I don't know about me, but it would be the evidence of salvation in my children, every one of them.
Right.
Amen?
Yes.
Honest, didn't you? Amen? I want to know that I've made a mark on my children's life. Amen? The Bible says to raise them up in the way that they should go, and when they are old, they will not depart from them. Amen?
Right.
We are all living proof to that because we're sitting in God's house tonight. Now faith is. So if you have something that you want to overcome, I guarantee you that you can overcome it, and you can overcome it now. The Bible says that we are to cast our cares upon him, for he cares for us. So when we experience the things of the world, which he says we will, he gives us a place to stand. Amen? A matter of fact, he tells us where to stand. Amen? He tells us how to stand. He tells us what to say when we're standing. He doesn't tell us to murmur and complain and walk around frustrated and bound up by the things of this world. He says to give me praise in all things. Brother Ronnie's been saying it. God's mercy is new every morning for you. Amen? Listen, the things that we hope for and evidence of things unseen, faith will take us there because the grace of God has already been distributed to everyone on this planet. Amen? You and I are in a position to receive that and operate in that, but it takes our faith to unfold that. Amen? Faith is what you believe in action. Faith is walking over and sharing your life with your neighbor. Faith is beginning to pray for somebody that looks like they could use some encouragement. And being willing to open up our mouth. Amen. Faith means making a commitment to be a part of the church, a member of the church. Amen. To be a member. To be committed in God's plan. Not only financially, but spiritually, emotionally. Amen. With our time, our talent, and our treasure, we've got nothing else to go back to. Amen. If you want to go back out, then go. But if you want to stay here and grow in the things of God, then feed your faith. Amen? Hallelujah. There's a lot of things that... yes, thank you, friend. That I have not seen that I want to see. There's a lot of things that I'm hoping for. But it was amazing. Shortly after we got married, and I was praying and I was thanking God because marriage is awesome. And I'm so grateful for what God has done through our marriage. And He's continuing to train me. Amen. Because not only did we see each other and fall in love, and God helped us make decisions that would honor Him in that courtship process, but now I'm learning to become one with her. Amen. And it's not always easy. Amen. She doesn't always come home fired up and ready to do things for me. And I don't always come home fired up and say, man, where's the honey-do list? I'm ready to tackle some things. Amen. So we begin to merge. We begin to do that. And the good thing is there's scripture involved. Because when scripture involved, that means there's truth involved. And when there's truth involved, that means you don't get to throw your selfish ambition and your own junk on somebody else and be okay with yourself. Amen? That we need to reconcile. The Bible says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Amen?
Amen.
I've watched our bed grow in the middle of the night. Because if we go to bed upset, she can move to a place I didn't know that existed in my room. Like, where did you go? Amen? Don't think you haven't been there. Don't think you haven't put on your worldly face and said, man, I don't just do nothing to me. You know, the only thing that breaks you out of that is the Word of God. Because you can come out of it through a Starbucks coffee, and guess what? You didn't really cover anything. You didn't go through anything and fix anything. All you did was get wound up on caffeine and go home twice as mad. Because while you were having coffee, you built four more expectations of why that person just did what they did. Amen? Think about it. But when you pursue the Word of God, then you have to reconcile. We never get married to fight and argue and see how disrespectful we can be with each other. Nobody ever signs up for that. But we need to go to God and learn how to do it right. Amen?
Amen.
And He does. He's awesome at that.
Amen.
But, God's saying but a lot tonight.
Yeah.
But without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he who comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. So we need faith to unlock. We need faith in our lives. We don't need the pastor's faith or our sister's faith. We need our own faith. Faith is the evidence of things unseen, the things that we hope for. And we can hear it every week when we come to church. We can experience it when we share stories with each other. Amen? We can experience it. But if we don't have our own, then something on the inside of us is left empty and alone. And God didn't create us to ever be alone. Matter of fact, He says you're not alone. That's a lie from the pits of hell. I created you just like you are, and I gave you a plan. Before you were even in your mother's womb, I predestined you. I foreknew you, the Bible says. Before you were ever even a plan, I had a plan. Amen? And so we are here tonight under the same purpose, to find out what that plan is. And it is to serve Him and to let Him remove the things in our life, to mature in our walk with Him so that we look more like Him tomorrow than we did today. Amen. Stand with me to your feet. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God.